Hi guys, it's Dinla and welcome to the Wolf's Den, and today is going to be a paranormal story time. This is going to be experiences that I had, fellow co-workers had, and my ZBC, aka my husband, had while working at this animal hospital. So to give you a little bit of background on this hospital, it was built in like the 60s or the 70s, maybe even the 50s. The veterinarian, the original one that owned it, actually lived in there. So there was a whole bathroom, like a tub and shower and kitchen. They had laundry, like facilities, because we had to wash. Well, we had to, past tense. So I don't work there anymore. Yeah, the doctor, the main vet who owned it, currently, when I worked there, her office used to be their bedroom. It had a nice plush carpet in there. Everything else was tile, though. So, because you know, bodily fluids come out of animals and weird places. So, everything in the hospital was tiled except for her office. They also used to cremate animals in this facility. They didn't at the time I worked there, but I did open up the incinerator, I guess you would call it, and look in there because I was just curious, and there were still ashes in there. I don't know if there were ashes of animals or remains of animals or if it was just trash, because I think they told me at one time they used to burn their trash instead of using the big rental trash cans and getting it dumped once a week type of thing. But I don't know. They had added on once they sold it to the new veterinarian who took over, because you have to be a veterinarian to own a veterinary hospital in North Carolina. You can't just buy one and own it and then hire vets, because that was like my dream, was to own a veterinary clinic. But I'd have to be a vet, and I can't afford to go to school. So, plus with my condition now, I can't do vet work. I can't lift over 10 pounds. The new vet had added on to the back of it and made a separate place for the small dogs. They're called runs, little kennels where they stay. So they had the old original part of the building, which were the big dog runs. Then they had the small dog runs, and then they had, in the middle of the back of the house, there was a surgical recuperating suite. They had four cages for like cats or small animals right outside the surgery room, and then they had like the bigger cages for bigger dogs that were about half the size of a run. They could just get up and move around just a little bit, but not too much, because you don't want them having too much activity after they've had surgery and they're waking up from anesthesia. They also had cages in there that were like overflow cages. If it was a holiday weekend, all the cages would be full. Also, if you would go further back and then take a right, there was a separate room in there that they had all the old file. Back behind that room was the parvo room, or the highly quarantined room. We treated dogs that had parvovirus or puppies that had it. Back there, you had to wear, you had to gear up head to toe with this like hazmat suit, had you put a pan down with bleach in it, and put on shoe covers, like rubber shoe covers, gloves, the whole nine yards, in order to change IVs out, or IV lines, not actual IV, flushing, making sure the pet's eating, and seeing how they're recovering, check for vomiting, diarrhea, you know, all that bad stuff that comes with the parvo. Many cases I dealt with that, because I actually started out in the kennel and worked my way up to a vet tech, and I was also cross-trained to be a receptionist, so I kind of knew everything, but my specialty was teching, and especially in the lab. But on holidays and days that, like hurricanes and stormy days and snow days, people didn't want to come in, I would come in, and I would be there all day until they sent me home. I remember one night time I actually spent the night there because it was really, really bad weather, and I didn't want the animals to be there by themselves, because the lights, the power might go out, might freak the animals out. It was a busy weekend, so I was just like, just let me stay the night, I'll put a sleeping bag down, I'm good. so I did that. But very old animal hospital. Plus, they used to cremate animals there, so there's that residual energy. So, and then we, of course, had to put animals to sleep, or we had emergencies where they didn't make it. And it's the sadder side of veterinary work, and that energy is there. Plus, the owners of the pets' energy is there. So, I have a few stories for myself, and then in part two, I'll talk about other people's experiences. My first experience was a small one. It was nothing really to write home about. I was out in the walking the large dog. It was a weekend, no air conditioner or heat was on because it was nice and cool already in the building and out in the runs. And that was in the part of the day where I was locked up. I had locked the rest of the building up because we would open in the mornings for drop off and then in the evening from like 4 to 5 for pickup on weekends for boarding only. And Saturday, Sunday we were just closed all day. So I think it was a Saturday and I was out walking the big dogs and I came in and shut the kennel door to the dog that I was walking, getting ready to let loose the next one, and I hear my name. Okay. I relatched the door because my name's Kirsten. It's not a common name. It's not an easy name to pronounce. A lot of people call me Kirsten, Kristen, Christian. So I keep tell people to call me Kitty or something like that, something easy. So I figured, like, the vet had come in, or a coworker had come in to check something or help me or something and didn't call because it was a secret line number that we had to call that we could answer that nobody, the public didn't have. And I went and looked around the whole building and nobody was there. There weren't any radios on because I checked because there was a TV in the break room and there was a radio in the grooming room back right before you get to the little dog runs, and it was not on. And I checked my walkie for interference because we use walkie talkies and the walkies weren't even on because, you know, it's a weekend, so I'm not going to have anybody to talk to. The next one kind of involves me. Whenever we were in the large dog runs and we were walking, because there was 26 large dog runs, no, 25, and 5 of them were separated for daily waters, and they had the big dog dryers in there for people that came in just for grooming or day boarding. And then there was a big wall, and the boarders that were like long-term boarding for 3 or more days were there. So I would always open the door and let the dog just run outside on his own, get some energy out, let them run around 15 minutes or so, bring them back in. And they would always slow down and meander to the opposite spur, or as close to the wall as they could, opposite of run 13. I don't know why. There was nothing special about the run. It looked just like the rest of them, but they would not walk next to the door on that run. I just thought that was weird, and I didn't even pay attention to what number it was until I happened to look up one day, and it was run 13. Another small thing that I think had to do with like the cremation of stuff there was I had been walking all the big dogs, and I was finished, and I had made sure they were all cleaned up, they were all locked in, I had locked the door out to get outside, and I look out the window, because in the large dog runs, they have windows that are fiberglass or plexiglass, but there's like wire over them so they can't get out. They can't like claw at them and break them or anything. And I look at them and I say, it's your little lab. So I'm thinking, okay, somehow I must have slipped through the fencing because the yard to let them run in was about 50 feet wide, about 20 feet long. It was separated between the big dogs and the little dogs, and each side had opening for the lawnmower people to come in and cut the grass. and I thought, okay, maybe wriggling its way in. We have had dogs climb over the fence, so I just thought with that, so I ran outside to see who it might have been, if I could catch it, put it in my day run until we found its owner, and there was no dog out there. There was no way that dog could have gotten it out of that area without me seeing it in that short amount of time. So it was a yellow lab, full grown, chubby. I remember it like it was yesterday, and it made me sad. It didn't like scare me or anything. It must have been somebody's pet from a while ago that was no longer with us physically but spiritually. I was going to walk the small dogs, and I had just gotten done with my lunch break, and I had been watching TV because there wasn't anything else to do, so I turned the TV off and went to go walk the little dogs, did that, came back in. I was switching out the laundry because we have to wash towels and blankets, because we always put blankets and towels in with the cats and dogs to make sure they're comfortable, along with their beds. We had these beds that somebody had made for us that were like cots, and we would put the blankets on the cots to make them comfortable in cages so the cats would be more comfortable. So we were doing that, and I was doing the laundry, and I was there by myself. It was a Sunday, and all of a sudden this TV turned on in the kitchen. So that freaked me out. So after that, if it was dark or getting dark, I was gone. And that wasn't even the worst one. I asked the owner of the animal hospital if Lazy NPC could come, because at the time he was working there. And I said, just to be there, he's not going to be on the clock. He's just going to sit in the break room and be there just in case I get freaked out, because I had told her about these experiences. And they have had experiences, and I will get to that in the next video. But my last experience was the straw that broke the camel's back. Once again, I was walking the large dogs and cleaning their runs. This was on a busy weekend. We only had, I think, 3 dogs staying, so I had the 3 dogs in the day boarding section, while I rinsed and cleaned out and washed their runs. And I went ahead and rinsed out the rest of the other runs too, just to get any dirt or fur out of them. And so I had all the doors, like almost all wide open. Door to the outside was shut. Air conditioner was not on. The heat was not on. The door to the kennel, to go into the kennel, both of them were shut, because there's a door from the surgery suite to come into and from the kennel room. And they were both shut. And all of a sudden, all at once, all the large doors, which are heavy gate doors, to each kennel shut at the same time, slammed shut. Luckily, Lazy NPC was there. I finished cleaning. I got the dogs situated in the day runs, because after that I didn't feel like they were safe in those runs. I just left them where they were and put bedding and food and water in there, and I left. And well, I made sure everybody had gotten their medications first, because we had a diabetic dog that we had to give insulin shots to at a certain time, so I had to wait until that time to get the insulin shot that I could make. But yeah, that was the last experience that I had. I know Lazy NPC had the door shut on him as well, and the name calling. I don't know about any other stuff that he's had. If he does have some stories, I'll have to ask him and make a part 3, because, or let him do it on his channel. If you like these paranormal type videos, let me know, because I really like paranormal stuff. It's my jam. I'm subscribed to like 100 paranormal channels here on YouTube videos. I love ghosts, conspiracy theories, cryptozoology, all that stuff. So, like, comment, subscribe, join the pack. We'd love to have you, and we'll see you in the next video. Bye.